Amen. Thank you, choir. It's good to see you in God's house today. There's a couple of things I want to share with you as a way of announcements this morning, and that is on September the 7th, that's on a Saturday night, and on September the 8th, that'll be a Sunday morning, we're going to have Friend Day here at Anthony Grove. And our goal is for every person to have a friend present, and that God would bless that friend in a special way. Now, do you have somebody you'd like God to bless? All right, so what you want to do is you want to sign them up, and we got thousands of these yellow cards out there. They're in the lobby, and they're the different places when you go in, and we're kicking off our Friend Day campaign today. Today, I'm supposed to have a friend signed up. Next week, all of the lay ministers and all of the staff is to have someone signed up as a friend. So if you're one of those, next week I'm going to expect you to stand up and hold up your card that you've got your friend signed up. The following Sunday, all of our church council members and all of our Sunday school teachers are to have a friend signed up. So on that Sunday, I'm going to say, all right, if you're a Sunday school teacher, if you're on the church council, hold up your cards. All right, and then on September the 1st, everybody is supposed to have a friend signed up. So I'm going to ask you on that Sunday to raise up your card, and we'll all see that we have a friend signed up. Now, you know how we like to have fun around here, so we're going to make a contest out of this. Who is the friendliest member at Anthony Grove? Well, just saying you are don't mean you are. The friendliest member is going to be the one that signs up and gets them to come the most friends for Friend Day. And I think in the past, Trey, I think you were 15 years old. We had Friend Day, and Trey signed up and got here 42 friends. Yeah. Now, he's 24. I don't know that he's the friendliest member anymore. We'll have to wait and see on Friend Day, okay? And here's what we want to do. We're going to recognize our friendliest friendly member the next Sunday, okay? And we're going to give them a prize. If you look back there in the back, we have a sign-up sheet for a trip we're going to take sometime in the future. It's called the Ark Encounter, all right? And our friendliest member is going to get to go to the Ark Encounter for free as a prize for being the friendliest person. That includes your ticket to get in, your transportation, your motel room for the friendliest member. Okay? Not only that, but remember, we're doing this on a Saturday night and we're doing it on Sunday morning. Now, why are we doing it on Saturday night? Well, if all of you bring a friend, there's no room for them to sit. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a Saturday night service and a Sunday morning service. And that don't mean you come to both of them. That means sign up your friend to come to one or the other, right? Now, if you sign up friends for Saturday and Sunday, you want to come for both of them just so that you can sit with your friends. But at each service, we're also going to take all the friends that are here. We're going to draw out, and they can win a trip to the Ark Encounter as well. So who can you count as a friend? Well, you can count your friends. You can count your relatives, because some of your relatives may not be your friends. You can count your coworkers. You can count your neighbors. You can count a stranger that waits on your table. I mean, you just carry a bunch of these cards around. You go out to eat, say, hey, we're having Friend Day at our church. Would you come be my friend? You just sign up friends anywhere. Now, let me show you how easy it is, okay? Scotty, I'm going to practice on you. Hey, Scott, how you doing?
I'm fine, sir.
Listen, we're having a friend day at Anthony Grove Baptist Church. We're having it on Saturday night, the 7th, and on Sunday morning at the 8th. Everybody's got to bring a friend, Scott. I need a friend. Would you be my friend on one of those days?
I would enjoy being your friend.
All right, well, which one would you rather come to? Saturday?
Saturday would probably
be all right,
be
all right. So let me write this down. And I'm going to put it here. That's September the 7th. That's Saturday. I'm writing down my name so that you can say when you come, I came as Dennis's friend. All right, I'm going to put it right here. Scott Sis, your address?
Right, 1915 Hasbro Church Road there.
All right, your email address?
Yeah.
Okay, and your phone number.
That's correct.
All right, now, okay, here's your reminder. Now, there's a little map on the back. Because some folks may not know where Anthony Grove's at. All right, a little map on the back, okay? And this here's a reminder. Put that on your refrigerator, okay?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you. Now, wasn't that easy? Now, do you think you can do that? Do you think you can go find somebody and say, hey, we're having a friend day. Everybody needs a friend. I need a friend. Would you be my friend? I believe you could get a coworker, a neighbor, a friend, a relative, an in-law, an outlaw. You get somebody who would come be your friend. And again, what is our goal? Our goal is that they will come. When they come, that the Spirit of God would fall and that God would bless them at whatever their need is, at the point of their need, that God would bless them either that Saturday night or that Sunday morning. So we got it? Everybody got it? All right, there's plenty of cards out there. You're going to take a handful when you leave, and we're going to find out who's the friendliest member. All right, now let me clarify something. Who can you count? I told you all those people. If they're not a member of Anthony Grove, you can sign them up. If they're a member of Anthony Grove but they haven't been in 6 months, you can sign them up. Okay? What's our goal? Everybody's going to have a friend. God's going to bless our friend. I believe that's a worthy goal. I believe that we can meet it. I got my friend signed up. I'm going to have one signed up next week. I'm going to have another one signed up the following week. I'm going to have another one the other week. I'm going to have more friends than Trey Newton. I hope. He's pretty good at it, so I put the bar pretty high, right? All right, so you see that. And in your tan sheet, it tells you our schedule, so you'll know when to come and to bring your card, your friend signed up. And then one other thing that I wanted to mention is we want this place to look good when our friends come. So this coming Saturday, we're going to have a work day. But the work day is going to be on the outside. So bring your rake, bring your pair of gloves, and we're just going to clean up outside and do some landscaping so that when our friends come, the place will look good. So if you can do that. And then inside your bulletin is a connection card. If you take a moment, fill out the front side. On the back side is a place to write down your prayer concerns. Hope you'll take a moment and do that. When the offering plate comes around, put your connection card in the offering plate. The ushers will bring those up. We'll have prayer over them at the end of the service. If you're visiting with us today, please fill out your card and hold on to it. And then when you exit out the lobby on the right-hand side, I'll be over at the Welcome Center. And if you'll bring me your card, I'll make sure it gets prayed over. But I have an information packet and a gift I want to give you. So please come by and see me on the way out. I want to ask God to bless our time together today. If you join your heart with mine. Heavenly Father, Lord, as the choir has sang so eloquently today, we thank you, God, that we can trust you in the good times and the bad times. We can trust you in the happy times. We can trust you in the hard times. We thank you, God, that you never leave us, you never forsake us, and that you're there with us every step of the way. Lord, may your presence be made manifest to us today. Holy Spirit, may you have freedom to move on every heart and every life. God, may glory come down today and flood our soul. May our worship ascend up to heaven and may it be a sweet fragrance, God, unto you. Bless now our time of worship in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. It's so awesome to be in God's house this morning, isn't it? Let's all stand and greet each other this morning.
Thank you.
stand as we continue to worship this morning. You know, I learned in Sunday school this morning that worshiping is a choice. Isn't that right? Worshiping is a choice.
We worship God because of who He is. He is worthy of our worship. We read in God's Word, each of you should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, Lord God, as we approach the throne of grace tonight, this morning, Lord God, we just give you praise and glory for who you are, Lord, our God and our Father, Lord, that always protects us. Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy that you so freely give us each day. Lord, my prayer this morning is for the people sitting before you in this sanctuary. Lord God, that there's one here this morning that needs you. Lord, that needs a touch from heaven. Lord God, I pray for that time, Lord, that you intervene in their life, Lord, and they'll raise up and take you by the hand and say, I need you for my life, and I forgive you for my sins, Lord. And Lord, that will happen today. Lord, we're so thankful that you allowed us to be here today, Lord, to worship you in truth and spirit. Lord, we just want to lift up and edify the name of Jesus Christ today. Lord, I pray for the pastor as he stands behind the pulpit, Lord God, that you'll give him whatever he needs, Lord, for the words that will be spoken, Lord, that will touch our hearts today. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you give us this opportunity once again. Now, Father, I pray for this offering, Lord, that you'll bless it and you'll multiply it, Lord, so that we can further your kingdom here at Anthony Grove in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
You may be seated.
Preacher's talking about Friends Day. I just want you to know this song I'm about to sing was inspired by my two good friends, Dale Sism and Steve Julian. Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you or the kindness you've shown? If you think there's a way I could ever repay all I've taken from you, maybe, Lord, I could show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to
continue to worship this morning. I want to ask you to stand with us. Praise God this morning. And if you have any worries, issues, you know what? God is good. good, good Father. That's who He is. Let's sing to Him.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am, your good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Remain standing, please.
Who is he? And who are you? You are loved by him. That's who you are. If you look inside your bulletin, you'll find an outline of today's message. Better not tempt me. The Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught his disciples to pray in this manner. Beginning at verse 9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye. Our Father, let's say it together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And then in Hebrews 4:15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, teach us to pray. And God, may each of us realize today, may we be inspired, O God, to pray that we be led not into temptation. Instead, God, we pray that you would deliver us from the evil one. Speak to us now, God, through your word. We'll make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We started a new series last week called Going Viral. And we looked at how things today can go viral, that is, spread very quickly to a lot of people in a short amount of time. And so we looked at the Bible app. It's a free Bible app called YouVersion. It has been downloaded 380 million times. And the four verses that we're going to look at in the month of August were the four verses that were searched, liked, and shared the most on the YouVersion Bible app. Last week we looked at Joshua 1:8, where it says that if we will meditate on God's word, hide its word in our heart, that we will do what? We will have success. So we looked last week about how we can succeed. I'm going to have to be honest with you. When I saw what was number 3 on the list, I was surprised. If I'd had to guess, I'd have guessed many times and got it wrong. Number 3 on the most liked, searched, and shared verses on YouVersion was Matthew 6:13. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And I got to thinking, how was that in the top 4 verses? And I thought, well, that's easy. All of us face temptation. And so in the temptations of life, a lot of people had shared this particular Bible verse. Now, I have a question. If I were to take the microphone, and I thought about doing this, and I thought, no, I'll embarrass somebody. And I would never do that intentionally. That is embarrassing. But I thought I'd just go around, I'd stick this microphone randomly at somebody and say, what is temptation? Aren't you glad I didn't do that? Because you're thinking, right now, huh? And here's another question I thought about passing the microphone around and putting it up there and say, where does temptation come from? Well, today I'm going to answer those questions. What is temptation and where does it come from? But more important, I'm going to tell you today from God's Word how you can overcome temptation. I don't know about you, but I'm interested in being victorious over temptation. I know all about being tempted. I want to know how to win when I'm tempted. And we're going to look at Jesus' example and learn from him. But the society that we live in today is full of temptation. You can't turn on your radio without being tempted. You can't turn on the television without being tempted. You can't open up a magazine heartily without being tempted. I read a story this past week about a family that grew up during the Dust Bowl out in Texas. And they were out there trying to eke out a living during the Dust Bowl. They were living out of an abandoned boxcar, this family. And they were trying to make a living farming. The place that they were working, the land that they were working, was rattlesnake infested. And the guy telling the story said him and his 11-year-old brother were out walking in the furrows where they had plowed, and they heard a rattlesnake. And the older brother, who was about 12 years old, was carrying a .22 rifle. And his little brother said, "Snake!" And his brother picked up that rifle and took aim, and he said, "I got it. Bam! I got him." He said, "No, you didn't, snake." And he shot again. He said, "I got him." He said, "No, you didn't. He's about to strike. Bam!" And he shot again. Snake fell over dead. You see, there were three rattlesnakes within 10 feet of where they were at. I don't know about you, but that doesn't sound like the kind of place I'd like to raise my children up in. I don't think that'd be the place I want to try to raise a family. But did you know that's the exact environment that you and I live in today? That the serpent, the devil, is all around us in all of the different kinds of media seeking to tempt us and to bring us down. So let's look at this verse. "Lead me not into temptation, but to deliver me from evil." The first thing I think when I look at this verse, why would I need to ask God not to lead me into temptation? I mean, would God actually tempt somebody to sin? And the first thing I want you to see is God does not tempt anyone to do evil. In James 1:13, "When tempted, no one should say, 'God is tempting me.' For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone." So when it says, "Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil," in Hebrew this is called a couplet. And that is, you have a statement, and the statement behind it amplifies the first statement. "Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil." What God is saying in this prayer is, both negatively and positively, God, help me with temptation. Don't lead me in the wrong way. Lead me in the right way and deliver me in whichever way I'm in. Playwright Oscar Wilde said it this way. He said, "I can resist almost anything except temptation." Anybody identify with that? I can resist almost anything except temptation. But when we are tempted, secondly, notice here, God helps you in the struggles of life. In 2 Peter Chapter 2 and verse 9, "Then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from temptation." So if I pray this prayer, God knows how to rescue me. He knows how to rescue you when we are faced with temptation. Notice there the prayer, "And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Notice here how God helps us. He helps us in three ways. Number one, he helps us with direction. Lead me not. That is, God will lead you in the right way if you ask him. And then the second way God helps us is by deliverance. If you find yourself in a tough spot, what will God do? God will deliver you. Remember Daniel when he was in the den of lions? Did God deliver him? Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And then number three, God helps us with dynamics. That is, he has the power to help us when we're tempted. When we were over in Israel, we were touring the Holy Land. Up in the northern part of Israel, you see signs everywhere around the Golan Heights bordering Syria. And it says, danger, landmines. And they're everywhere, aren't they, Leonard? And what you know is this. You don't see them, but they're there. You don't see them, but they're real. You don't see them, but they're dangerous. You may not see the demons, you may not see the devil, but I want you to know the devil is real, demons are real, and temptation is real. And God will give you the power to overcome and to win temptation. On the inside of your outline, notice there how Jesus overcame temptation. We're going to switch over to Luke chapter 4 and look at Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. How did he handle it? How did he get victory? Because we can get victory the same way. Number one, we see the subject of temptation. In Luke 4, 1 and 2, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Do you find out that you're tempted a lot? Do you think, there must be something wrong with me that I face all of these temptations in life? Now, there's not anything wrong with you. Jesus was the perfect Son of God, and yet he was tempted. When you're tempted, it doesn't mean that anything's wrong with you. It means that the devil is simply opposing you. Can you keep a bird from flying over your head? Not really. But you can keep the bird from building a nest in your hair, can't you? Well, you can't prevent temptation from coming into your life, but you can win the battle over temptation. In Hebrews 4:15, we have this promise. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. I don't know about you, but it's a comfort to me that Jesus was tempted just like I am in every way. Now get this, the devil's going to tell you that your situation is different, that nobody else has had it as bad as you are. That's a lie. Jesus was tempted in every way just like you are. You say, oh, preacher, that can't be true. The devil never was tempted. I mean, he never tempted Jesus to run a red light. He's not been tempted in every way like I have. He was, and I'm going to show you how in a moment. But notice he was tempted in every way just like we are, yet without sin. Now here's my question to you. Do you want to overcome temptation? You see, there was a time in my life when I liked temptation. Because the temptation was to sin, and sin was fun, and I enjoyed it, so I was looking for temptation. I liked it. I'm wondering how many folks here today do not pray, Lord, lead me not into temptation because you like it. Reminds me of this fellow went to the doctor. He said, Doc, I've been misbehaving. I've been really bad. And he said, my conscience is bothering me. And I've come to see if you could help me with this. And the doctor looked at him. He said, oh, you want me to give you something to help you with your willpower? He said, no. I was hoping you could give me something that would weaken my conscience. In other words, he didn't want to change. He didn't want to have victory over temptation. He just didn't want to be bothered by it when he failed. So number one, we see the subject of temptation. Number two, we see the setting of temptation. Let's back up a few verses. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, you are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. All right, so when does this temptation take place? The setting is right after Jesus was baptized. Have you ever thought about why Jesus was baptized? You know, he didn't need to be baptized. Baptism is a form of identification. When Jesus was baptized, he was identifying with you. He was identifying with me. And when I ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart, I get baptized because now I am identifying with him. See how that works? He was baptized to identify with us. We are baptized to identify with him. It's like I wear a wedding band, Teresa wears a wedding band. But it was at his baptism that it took place. Are you watching? Many times temptation will come to you right after a spiritual high. I mean, think about it. Jesus is at the Jordan River. John has baptized him. Heaven is opened up. The glory of God has fallen upon him. And immediately he was taken into the wilderness and tempted. I know y'all know what I'm talking about. You've been to church, the Spirit of God moved. You leave the church so happy. And you and your spouse get in a fight before you ever get home. I mean, how did that happen? Huh? How did that happen? In the military, it's called a counterattack. Attack, counterattack. So you're on the spiritual high. You've attacked the devil. What does the devil do? He comes around and does a counterattack. You see, a lot of times we're expecting temptations when we're in a low spot and we're not looking for it on the high spot. You see, the setting of the temptation was right after a spiritual high. All right, now there's a note here. I want you to get this. The setting does not determine the outcome. Listen, I'm all in favor of a better environment. I'm all for our children growing up in a Christian home. I'm all in favor of them growing up in a Christian environment. But the environment you're in does not determine the outcome. This is a lie straight out of hell called the social gospel. And the social gospel is no gospel at all. What does the social gospel say? The social gospel says if you change the environment of people, put them in a good environment, then they will turn out to be good people. Lie, lie, lie. You don't change people by changing their environment. You change the environment by changing people. You see, if you have a heart change, you're going to change what's around you. What's around you doesn't change you on the inside. You say, now, preacher, I don't know if I agree with that. Well, that's okay. You can be wrong. Now, I'm going to prove it to you from the scripture. Adam was tempted in the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden was paradise on earth. Adam failed temptation in paradise. Jesus overcame temptation in the wilderness. The environment did not determine the outcome. You got to quit believing the lie. If you just had a better marriage, if you just had a better home, if you had a better job, you could win the battle in life. It has to do with who is on the inside of you, not who is on the outside of you. Number three, we see the source of temptation. Verses 1 and 2, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. C.S. Lewis says in the Christian faith there's two extremes you need to avoid. Number one is when you look at demonic and the devil and you see, oh, well, I don't believe in demons. I don't believe in devil. It's just a metaphor for evil. There's not a real devil. That's one extreme. He said, don't believe that, because it's not true. The other extreme, he says, you need to avoid is when you see a demon under every rock. Everything that you see in life, oh, that's a demon, that's a demon. Don't give them that much credit, okay? Don't be on one extreme or the other extreme. You say, oh, preacher, shouldn't we be up on our enemy? Shouldn't we study up on the devil and the demons? No. The FBI doesn't study counterfeit money. They study real money. And when they've studied the real money, they can spot the fake money. Listen, you and I, we need to focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to focus on God, not on the devil, not on the demons. And if you know the real thing, if you know the real spirit of God, you can identify that which is an evil spirit because you know the good spirit. Don't get sucked into this lie of studying the enemy. And by the way, You may not have dealt with this, but I had to deal with it in school. Dr. Bob, I'm sure you did. I had liberal professors that would stand up there and say, there's no such thing as a real, literal devil. It is only the personification of evil. It's only a metaphor of evil. I just laugh at that. Because, see, in Mark chapter 5, Jesus landed on the shore, and there was a man possessed by many demons. Jesus spoke to the demons on the inside of him and said, what is your name? And he said, my name is Legion, for we are many. A Roman legion was made up of 6,000 soldiers. So this man might have had 6,000 evil spirits in him. And so Jesus cast the evil spirits out into a herd of swine. That is, there's 2,000 pigs. And they said, Jesus, allow us, permit us to go into the pigs. And he did. And what happened was, is those evil spirits came out of the man, went into the pigs, they ran off a cliff and committed pigicide. And I asked a liberal professor, I said, what made those pigs run off the cliff? Was it a metaphor that made them do that? No, it was an evil spirit. And if you're a child of God, you have three enemies in life: the flesh, the world, and the devil. And they're all real. But notice here what it says in Hebrews 4:15. I want us to keep coming back to this. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Was Jesus ever tempted to smoke dope? Nope. Well, I thought he was tempted in every way just like we are. Well, when the Bible says that, it is saying that you can only be tempted in one of three categories, and Jesus was tempted in every one of those three categories. What are the three categories that we are tempted in? Well, you see all three of them in one verse. 1 John 2:16. Let's look at it. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, And the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. Did you notice there's three different categories of temptation? Jesus, when he was tempted in the wilderness, three different times by the devil, each one of them's a different category. When Adam and Eve were tempted in the garden, there were three different categories that Adam and Eve were tempted in. Every temptation that you have falls within these three categories. Therefore, Jesus was tempted in every way, just like you. What were those three areas? Number one, the lust of the flesh. In Luke chapter 4, verse 3, the devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Notice here, this is a temptation of doing. If you are the Son of God, turn the rocks into bread. Notice here that the temptation is a temptation of the flesh. Jesus hadn't had anything to eat for 40 days. Most of us can't go 40 hours. He hadn't had anything to eat in 40 days. Guess what? He was naturally hungry. He had a natural appetite. Did you know it's okay to be hungry? But notice here what he is tempting him to do. He is tempting him to satisfy a real need in his life, but do it in a way that does not match up with the Word of God. Every temptation is you trying to satisfy a need in your life that does not match up with God's will. That's what a temptation is. Turn these stones. Now, why would you say that? Think about it. The stones were round, smooth. When you take how bread was, you could go buy Merita bread at the grocery store all sliced up. It looked just like one of those stones. And he said, so turn the stone into bread. The first temptation is that of the flesh. You and I, we have human flesh, and those flesh has appetites. And so we are tempted to satisfy those appetites in a way that doesn't please God. Do you understand? If I'm hungry, if I go eat something that's good and healthy, that's not a sin. But if I'm hungry and I go eat something that's going to hurt me, that's a sin. Did you know you have a natural appetite called sex? And did you know if you try to satisfy that in a way that doesn't please God, that's called sin? But if you satisfy it in a way that honors God, then it's not sin. You see, we all have the temptations of the flesh. And so that's the temptation of doing. Turn this stone, do something. And then secondly is the lust of the eyes. And this has to do with having. Not doing, but having. Notice here the next verse. The devil took him up and showed him in a second all the kingdoms of the world. I will give you all of this power and all this wealth, the devil told him. Have you ever heard this expression, feast your eyes on this? Well, it's a category of temptation. That is the lust of the eyes. Notice what the devil did. He took him up on top of the tower. He took him up on this high place and he said, look around. And he showed him and he said, if you will do this, I will let you have all of this wealth. The lust of the eyes is the temptation to have stuff. Now, is it a sin to have stuff? No. Is greed a sin? Yes. What is greed? It's when I have an unholy desire for more things than I need. Do you understand that our whole economy is based on this second category of temptation? The United States economy is two-thirds consumer spending. So Madison Avenue and Wall Street want you to buy, 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 spend, spend, spend. How many of you have seen something and thought, oh, I got to have it. I got to have it to be happy. And then you bought it, and after you bought it, you still weren't happy. After you bought it, you look back and say, what was I thinking? Why did I get this? I bought it. I don't even know how to use it. It's the same temptation. Right, now think about it. Jesus is tempted what? To have all of this stuff. In the garden, when Eve was tempted of the tree of good and evil, she saw that it was good for food. That's the first temptation. When she looked at it, the Bible says it was pleasing to the eye. The second temptation. All right, and then the third category that you can be tempted is the pride of life. Verse number 9, the devil led him to Jerusalem, had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you're the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. The pride of life. Took him up to the temple and said, hey, if you'll make a big flashy show, Jesus, everybody's going to say, oh, wow, isn't that awesome? Isn't he awesome? You know, we have an Easter drama around here, right? And there's a time in the past where we have tried to show the ascension of Jesus where he goes up, you know, at the end. And we've always thought about, is there a way we could get one of them little skinny guy wires and we could have Jesus standing here and it'd be hooked up to him and he'd start going up, 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 and then he'd go through the ceiling. Wouldn't that be cool? That'd be cool, wouldn't it? Well, the devil's just doing this in reverse. We're going to put you up here on the top, and you just jump down. But instead of falling, you just kind of float on down. Jesus, and everybody said, ooh, ah, wow. You see, one of the temptations is just the pride of life, to make ourselves look good. Going back to Eve and Adam in the garden, what was the temptation of the devil? When you eat of this, you will not die, but you will become like God, knowing both good and evil. What was the temptation? To be like God. It was the pride of life. Look at me. Look what I've done. All of your temptations are going to come through one of these three categories. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, or the pride of life. And that brings me to number 4. How can we win this battle of temptation? We see here the subduing of temptation in 2 Corinthians 2:14. But thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ. You can't stop from being tempted, but you can win the battle of temptation. There's a guy, and he's a boxer, and he's out there, and he's a boxing, and he's just taking a beating out in the ring. He comes over into the corner, and he's got blood running out of his eyes. He's bruised up. I mean, he's just been beat bad. And he looks up to his manager, and he said, throw in the towel. Throw in the towel. I'm taking a beating out there. He says, we're done here. And his manager wiped it all off, and he's patting him. He said, oh, champ, you're doing great. You're doing great. You go out there and get him. He ain't laid a glove on you yet, champ. You got this, champ. And the boxer looked up at him, and he says, coach, when I get back out there, I want you to keep the eye on the ref because somebody's tearing me up out there. Well, you may not know where it's coming from. But there are folks right here today, and your testimony is you've been taking a beating. You've been taking a beating by the world, by the flesh, by the devil. And by the way, I just want to tell you something. Let me tell you why the devil is after you so hard. The devil is after you so hard because he hates God. And the devil knows he can't whip God. He can't touch God. So what's the next best thing? If you can't hurt somebody they love. Satan can't hurt God. So he wants to hurt those that God loves. And who are you? I am loved by God. So that's why you have a bullseye on. But notice here, Jesus out in the wilderness, he won. He applied some principles. I'm going to cover these very quickly, all right? Number 1, the principle of sonship. In Luke 3:21, when all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened. The Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son whom I love." You want to beat the devil? The only way to beat the devil is to be a child of God. You can't beat the devil unless you're his son or his daughter. You have to ask Jesus to come into your heart. You have to ask him to wash away your sins. You have to be born again into the family of God. And if not, you're not going to win temptation. The first thing he heard was, "You are my son and whom I love." I have a grandchild. He'll be 4 next month. Okay? And when Teresa and I get around him, he wants me to play chase. And so we'll run, and I'll chase him, and then we'll stop. He'll chase me, and we'll do that for a while. And then he'll go over there, and he'll say, "Nana, you chase me." And he'll grab my hand and say, "Come on, Paul, let's go." And we'll run, and Teresa will act like she's trying to chase us. And we'll run around, and she'll stand over there, and she'll wait on us. And when we come around the corner, and she'll jump out, and he'll scream, "Ah!" And we'll turn around, and we'll run the other way. And we'd do this a couple of times. But then what happened after a couple of times, we'd go around there, and there she is, and she says, "Ah!" And he'll reach up, and he said, "Get me, Paul!" And I'll grab him up and in my arms, and we go running away. It's tough toting a 40-pound-year-old child around. Now think about it. He makes me run around and get tired before he ever says, "Come on, Paul, let's go." But what he has recognized is, if he's in my arms, he's going to be safe. If he's in my arms, nobody's going to get him. And so what you have to realize is, and when you are tempted, you got to run into the arms of the Father. You got to say, "Here am I, Father. I am loved by you. Pick me up. Hold me. Protect me. Keep me from the temptation." And God will. And God will. And then secondly, the principle of submission. In verse 22, "And the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, 'You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased.'" Notice it's not only sonship, but it's submission. Jesus was submitted to doing the will of the Father. Some of you here today, you don't have victory in your life. You want me to tell you why you don't have victory in your life? You've allowed some things to creep into your life. And because you're living a worldly, carnal, Christian life, you don't have victory because God's not pleased with your life. You see, you can't go around in disobedience to God and then say, "Oops, God, get my fat out of the fire." Doesn't work that way. You have to be submitted. "Not my will, but your will be done." You see, sometimes what we have to do is we have to run from temptation. Daniel was delivered from the lion's den. Notice he didn't go inside the den of lions and say, "Here, open up the doors, guys. I'm going to go in." And he'd look at those lions and say, "Now I dare you to bite me." You see, so many times what happens is you walk right into temptation, and you dare the devil to bite you. If my life is not pleasing to God, he's not going to give me victory while I'm in disobedience. Number 3, the principle of spiritual power. Notice there in verse 1, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan, was led by the Spirit in the desert. Now, if you skip down to verse 14, after the 40 days, what happens? Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. How did Jesus overcome temptation? He had the power of God on his life. He prayed, the Spirit of God fell, heaven opened up, he went out into the wilderness in the power of the Holy Spirit. After he left the wilderness, he went to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit. You will not beat the world. You will not beat the devil on your own. You will only do it by the spiritual power that God brings. Some of you remember what happened in the Great Recession a couple years ago? Remember the saying that was going around Wall Street about certain companies, "They're too big to fail"? "Oh, we can't let GM fail, they're too big to fail. We can't let Bank of America fail, they're too big to fail." You remember that? Well, there's some Christian people who have the same thinking. Well, you know what? I'm too big. I'm too strong. I'm too mature to fail. If you fight the devil by yourself, you will fail every time. I've never seen a woman, I've never seen a man that could whoop a lion by themselves. Unless it was in a Tarzan movie. And you understand that was a tame lion. The Bible says that Satan is like a roaring lion seeking whom he can devour. And how do you resist him? You do it by being in the power of the Spirit of God. Recognize you can't do it, God can. And then number four, the principle of scriptural knowledge. In verse 8, Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him alone." Now, a while ago when I said I hadn't seen a man or a woman that could whip a lion, I know what some of you are thinking. Well, I could whip one with a 308 and a big scope. But we were talking about hand to hand. But notice the child of God has something, and that is they have the Word of God. And the Bible says that the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. And Jesus defeated the devil with the sword of the Spirit. He quoted the Word of God. It is written. Let me tell you how you can whoop the devil. Memorize some scripture. But here's the key. You got to memorize scripture that has to do with the temptation. John 3:16 don't work when you're tempted with pornography. Why is that? John 3:16 don't have anything to do with pornography. But let me give you a good verse that will help you. Psalm 101 verse 3. Psalm 101 verse 3. It says, "I will not set before my eyes no vile thing." So when you're tempted to look at something on your phone, you're tempted to look at something on your tablet, when you're tempted to look at something on your television, you just have that little post-it note right up there on the screen. It said, "I'll put no vile thing before my eyes." Now, some of you, that's not your temptation. Your temptation is temper. You just lose your temper just like that. You get mad and you say things you don't wish you had said. Well, you need to memorize Ephesians 4:30. "Be ye angry and sin not." You see, the Word of God that you use has to deal with the temptation you're being tempted with. Number five, the principle of satisfaction. You understand the world, the flesh, and the devil cannot tempt you if you're satisfied. Matthew 6:11, this same prayer says, "Give us today our daily bread." Have you ever tried to take a bone away from a dog? Is that a good idea? If you try to take a bone away from a dog, what's probably going to happen to you? You're probably going to get bit, right? But I'm going to tell you how to take a bone away from a dog every time and not get bit. I'm going to tell you how to face temptation every time and not lose. And that is be satisfied with Jesus. You see, if that dog's chewing on that bone and I go over and I have a big old juicy ribeye steak and I throw that juicy ribeye steak down, that dog going to drop that bone. He's going to go after that steak. You see? And the principle of satisfaction is something like this. If I let Jesus satisfy my needs, then the devil cannot tempt me. One fellow said it this way: if you got filet mignon at home, you can't be tempted with bologna at work. Amen? And so what is it? Remember, every temptation has to do with what? Being, doing, and having. If I have Jesus and I'm doing the will of God and I'm a child of God, satisfied with Jesus, no temptation will come to me that I cannot win. Isn't that good? The principle of satisfaction. And then lastly is the principle of supplication. "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Let me tell you how Jesus won temptation in the wilderness. He's prayed up before he ever went there. Did you notice there where it says Jesus was praying and heaven opened up and the Spirit came down? He prayed before he ever went in the wilderness. He prayed before he was ever tempted. You and I need to pray every day, God, lead me not into temptation. God, deliver me from evil. You are as strong as your prayer life. Martin Luther, the great Reformation leader, had bouts with the devil all the time. And somebody said, Martin, how are you victorious over the devil? I love what he said. He said, every time the devil comes and knocks at the heart of my door, I say, Jesus, would you go answer the door, please? What was he saying? He says, when the temptations come and knocks at my heart door, if I send Jesus to answer it, I will win every time. What he was saying is that I'm prayed up before I ever get into wilderness. I'm prayed up before I ever go into the battle. I am prayed up before I ever face the temptation. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I'm going to ask you to bow your head. Nobody's looking around. Jesus started this prayer by saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. If you're here today and you have never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you will never win the battle of temptation. You must first come and say, Jesus, come into my heart and make me a child of God. If you have never done that, would you make that step today? Would you step out, come to this altar, take me by the hand and say, Pastor, I want Jesus to come into my heart and my life. I want to be a son of God. I want to be a daughter of God. I want to have the power of the King on my side. Might be that you've made that decision already, but you haven't made it public. Remember, Jesus was baptized to identify with us, and we are baptized to identify with Him. Would you come today and identify with Jesus, make your decision public, present yourself as a candidate for baptism? I'm wondering who is here today and you'd say, God, I want to have victory in my life. I want to have victory over temptation, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. I wonder who would come today and say, God, I don't want to be bullied anymore by the devil. I want to live a victorious life, full of the Spirit of God, walking in victory. You can have victory today in whatever area you're being tempted in. Jesus has been tempted in that very same area, and He will give you victory today. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank You for Your Word. I thank You for the example of Your Son. And may we come now at this time, Lord, and make the decisions that we need to make that we can enjoy the victory that You have promised. Lead us now, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would please stand as we sing, we invite you to come. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Church, it's my privilege to introduce to you the newest member of our family. This is Jackson. This past week during Vacation Bible School, he was one of those who committed his heart and life to Jesus Christ. He comes today to make it public. What is your favorite, church? We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Welcome to the family. If you'll be seated right here, Peggy will get your information. Of course, that's Josh and Megan, his parents. By the way, let me just tell you how God works. Josh and Megan are members here at the church. Josh got his PhD in mathematics and economics, and he has been transferred to New Orleans, and then he went from Louisiana to West Virginia. They've been down here for a couple weeks in the summertime. They were here at Bible school. Josh got to play in the praise band today. We're excited about that. But got saved while he was down here from West Virginia. So we're excited. He's going to go back to West Virginia as a missionary. Yeah. Amen. Isn't God good? All right. If you look inside your bulletin, you'll find a prayer list there. It's a little white sheet. Looks like this. Pastor Ken is preaching up in Canton. That's where he's at. And him and Bonita and Tracy are also up there with them singing. But if you'll take your list there of names, I want to just simply say to you that we want to pray for all of these that are on this list. And then we have one that we'd like to add. Under bereavement, the Robert Loveless Sr. family. If you add that one to your list, we'll continue to pray for all of these that are on here. Some of them have gone home from the hospital. We thank God for that. God knows each of these needs. If you have a need and you'd like to lift it up to God, we just raise your hand. All right, I have all these connection cards here. We're going to pray over those. Let's join our hearts together as we go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for our answered prayer. Thank you, God, for the invitation to cast all of our cares upon you. Lord, I lift up every name that's on these connection cards. I lift up every hand that has been raised. I pray, God, that you would bless and move in each one that your Son might be glorified in the answer. Lord, as we depart from this place, may we go in your peace, may we go in your power, and may we say to a lost and dying world that Jesus has set us free and that they can be free in him. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming. God bless you.
Thank you.
Billy. Trend.